Welcome to Peterson's DSST Money and Banking Instructional Videos. These videos will highlight the content you need to pass your DSST exam. Throughout these lessons, you will see definitions and concepts in bold. These are important terms to remember for exam day. Be sure to apply your knowledge of these concepts in Peterson's online practice tests. Let's get started. Part 1. The roles and kinds of money and macroeconomic activity. Let's start by defining the concept of money. Money is an asset, a durable item with value that is widely accepted as a means of payment. Only some valuables or assets can be used as money. Assets that can be used as money are durable, they last over time, acceptable, people do not find them repulsive or inconvenient to carry, divisible, they can be divided into smaller units, fungible. Each unit is similar to every other unit so that they can be easily interchanged. Economists find that money has four key roles. The first is means of payment. Money makes it easier for buyers and sellers to come together and trade. Without money, people would have to barter. That is, exchange one good for another. However, bartering requires a double coincidence of wants. That means both parties have to want what the other has. For example, if Joe wants to trade his Netflix subscription for a DSST study guide, he has to meet someone who has a DSST study guide they don't want, and who wants a Netflix subscription. Because money is widely accepted as a means of payment, when Joe wants to trade money for a DSST study guide, he can easily find a bookstore willing to trade a DSST study guide for money. Another role of money is store of value. An important feature of money is that people can save it for future purchases. If snowballs were used as money, our wages would melt before we could spend them. Money is also the standard for deferred payment. Money is the unit we use to agree on the future repayment of a debt. In the United States, the Coinage Act of 1965 states that the dollar is legal tender and must be accepted as repayment for all debts. This is the main reason we use dollars as our money. Finally, money is the unit of account. Money is the reference measure to set prices and to evaluate important economic indicators. Throughout history, societies have used three kinds of money. In past centuries, people have used various commodities like gold and silver as money. Commodity money is inconvenient because it is heavy to carry, it is easy to debunk, and its value swings with changes in the demand and supply of the commodity. In more recent times, private and central banks started issuing paper certificates backed by gold that proved a more convenient means of payment. Under the gold standard, the dollar was backed by gold. At any time, the carrier of a dollar bill could visit the central bank and have the dollar bill converted into gold. Nowadays, most money is in the form of paper certificates that are not backed by gold or any other commodity. This is called fiat money, because its value comes from people's trust that now and in the future, the certificates will be accepted as a means of payment. The quantity of money in an economy is called the money stock, or the money supply. In the United States, the Federal Reserve Bank uses two monetary aggregates. One, M1, which includes cash in circulation, checking accounts, and traveler's checks. Two, M2, which includes M1 and savings accounts, small-time deposits, and retail money market mutual funds. Money is a type of financial asset, an asset that derives value from a contractual claim. A loan is a type of financial asset that derives value from a contract that states that the borrower will pay money to the lender at some point in the future. Another important class of financial assets is represented by securities. These are financial assets that can be traded. There are three classes of securities. 1. Debt securities. Tradable IOUs like banknotes and bonds. 2. Equity securities. Standardized ownership shares like common stock. 3. Derivatives. Contracts where flows of money depend on the realization of uncertain events like futures, options, and swaps. Unlike cash, other financial assets often pay interest. In a credit transaction, the money lent out at the start is called the principal. while the interest is all the extra payments the lender receives from the borrower over the duration of the transaction. The interest rate is the ratio of interest to principal. Interest rates are measured in basis points. A basis point is 0.01%. The interest rate is easy to compute in the case of a simple loan, where a person lends M dollars to another and receives N dollars back at maturity. In the case of fixed payment loans, for example, a home mortgage loan or a coupon bond, computing the interest rate is more difficult. There is a negative relationship between the price of a debt security, say a bond, and the interest rate. Bond prices increase when the demand for bonds increases and decline when the supply of bonds increases. Therefore, a higher demand for bonds leads to higher bond prices and lower interest rates. A higher supply of bonds leads to lower bond prices and higher interest rates. Debt securities can be more or less risky, depending on the probability that the issuer might default or not repay. Riskier securities are cheaper and pay a higher interest rate than safe securities. Credit rating agencies are firms that research the likelihood that different issuers might default and rate issuers' bonds accordingly. A yield curve is a graph that shows the interest rate on similar securities with different terms to maturity, the time remaining before the principal is repaid. For example, a 3-month Treasury bill versus a 10-year Treasury bond. There is also a relationship between the slope of the yield curve and investors' expectations of the future behavior of short-term interest rates. If investors believe that short-term interest rates will soon rise, the yield curve becomes steeper. If investors believe that short-term interest rates will soon decline, the yield curve becomes flatter or even downward sloping. Before diving into the theories, let's review some common economic terminology. Economists call total output the amount of goods and services an economy produces in a year, and they track total output using an economic indicator called gross domestic product, GDP. Potential output is the level of output the economy produces when inputs, labor in particular, are fully employed and the economy operates efficiently. Gross domestic product is the value of all final goods and services produced for the market over a period of time in the country. A final good is an item that is not used and totally transformed in production over the same period. GDP has four components: consumption, investment, government spending, and net exports, the difference between exports to other nations and imports from other nations. Consumption counts families' expenditures in durable and non-durable goods. Investment has two components: fixed investment, which counts expenditures on residential and non-residential structures and firms' purchases of new equipment and machinery, and inventory expenditure, which counts changes in firms' holdings of materials, parts, and final products. The payment people receive for their work or financial investment is called income. Economists track income using the economic indicator net national income, NNI. Net national income has four components: wages and salaries, rents, interest, and profit. Economists call disposable income, DI, the difference of net national income and net taxes. Every year, families pay a portion of their income in taxes and receive a portion of their income as transfers from government Social Security pension. Net taxes are the difference between taxes and transfers. Families spend a portion of their disposable income, after taxes income, in consumption, just like the GDP component, and save the rest. Hence, disposable income is the sum of consumption and saving. The price level is an average of all prices and is tracked using several indicators. For example, the Consumer Price Index, CPI, or the Personal Consumption Expenditures, PCE, deflator. Inflation is a continual and generalized increase in the price level. The inflation rate measures how fast prices are increasing. Unemployment is the number of jobless workers in search of work. Employment is the number of workers who have jobs. The unemployment rate is the ratio of unemployment to the labor force. The sum of unemployment and employment. When people are out of work because they don't have skills in demand, they are deemed structurally unemployed. When people are out of work due to a low level of economic activity, they are deemed cyclically unemployed. The economy is called at full employment when there is no cyclical unemployment. The interest rate is the proportion of a loan or of the value of a debt security that is charged as interest. The real interest rate is the difference between the interest rate and the rate of inflation people feel will prevail in the future. Classical economists believe the economy is self-regulating and advocate for a laissez-faire, let-it-be approach to economic policy. According to the classical model, total output follows the amount of labor input and capital input used in production. These amounts are determined in highly competitive markets where flexible prices absorb any change in demand or supply. In the labor market, workers' and firms' decisions are driven by the real wage, the amount of goods the monetary wage can buy. The supply of labor is an upward-sloping line illustrating that at higher wages, more people are willing to work. The demand for labor is a downward-sloping line illustrating that at higher wages, firms have lower profit margins and hire fewer workers. The market is in equilibrium when firms pay the wage rate where the demand for labor is equal to the supply of labor. Flexible real wages that move in response to changes in demand and supply maintain the market in equilibrium at all times. When the labor market is in equilibrium, people willing to accept the current wage have found a job, and the only people out of work are those who don't wish to work for the current wage. There is no involuntary unemployment. The key idea of the classical model is that the market for goods and services is in equilibrium at all times because supply creates its own demand, a statement that is often referred to as Say's Law. Classical economists noted that for every $10 of output a firm produces, $10 of income is paid to workers and entrepreneurs. If in one way or another all of this income is spent to buy goods and services, the very act of producing an item creates the demand for that item. In the classical model, the market for capital makes sure savings would equate investment, so all income distributed would come back to firms in the form of demand, some as consumption and some as investment. Families and firms base their saving and investment decisions primarily on the real interest rate. The supply of funds is upward sloping, as families are more willing to postpone consumption and save when the interest rate is higher. The demand for funds is downward sloping, as a decline in the interest rate lowers borrowing costs and increases the number of investment projects that are profitable. In equilibrium, the demand for loanable funds equals the supply of loanable funds, and investment equates saving. Keynesian economists believe the economy fails to self-adjust at times and that economic policy, in particular higher government spending, can help maintain the economy at full employment. According to these economists, prices and wages are sticky and total output follows aggregate expenditures. Aggregate expenditures are the sum of four components: consumption, planned investment, government purchases, and net exports. Consumption expenditure is the largest of the four components, and, according to the Keynesian model, it's positively related to current disposable income. Consumption sensitivity to disposable income is called the marginal propensity to consume, MPC. C equals autonomous consumption plus MPC times disposable income. Planned investment is the sum of planned fixed investment and planned inventory investment. Keynes agreed with the classical economists that it is negatively sensitive to changes in the cost of borrowing and the real interest rate. I equals autonomous investment minus D times real interest rate. Government purchases add directly to total spending, while taxes reduce total spending indirectly, reducing disposable income and lowering consumption. Net exports are sensitive to changes in the foreign exchange rate, to the relative price of domestic and foreign goods, and to global economic conditions. A higher interest rate influences the foreign exchange rate and leads to an appreciation of the domestic currency. As a result, net exports are negatively sensitive to the interest rate. In the Keynesian model, the market for goods and services can be in equilibrium with the economy operating below its potential level and workers being involuntarily out of jobs. Also, since consumption is sensitive to disposable income, changes in aggregate expenditure are amplified by a multiplier effect. According to Keynesian economists, a decline in investment lowers aggregate expenditure and increases inventory investment above its planned level. Firms that see their finite product pile up in their warehouses, cut production, and let some workers go. As prices and wages are sticky, the real wage does not decline when labor demand drops and unemployment rises as the economy slows down. Many workers out of jobs are involuntarily unemployed at the current monetary wage at which they would accept work. In modern terminology, they are cyclically unemployed since weak spending is behind their joblessness. After World War II, Keynesian economists believed that the government could run public deficits during economic downturns and surpluses during expansions to fine-tune the economy, that is, to preempt possible swings in economic activity. They also thought that the central bank could stimulate the economy with little consequence for the inflation rate. A study of empirical data had found a negative relationship between the inflation rate and the unemployment rate, called the Phillips curve, and some Keynesian economists believe this relationship to be structural and immutable, providing the central bank with a policy trade-off. During the 1960s and 1970s, however, the yearly inflation rate increased from 1.2% in 1964 to 11.8% in 1974, and economists' focus shifted from maintaining the economy at full employment to understanding and fighting inflation. It is in these years that a new theory called monetarism came into the fold. Monetarists believed that fiscal policy is ineffective at stimulating the economy and that monetary policy can affect economic activity in the short run, while it affects only prices and inflation in the long run. These economists believed that due to long policy lags, monetary policy would disrupt the economy instead of stabilizing it, and suggested a fixed rate of growth of the money supply as the optimal policy. Monetarists believed that inflation is always a monetary phenomenon and stressed the importance of expectations during inflationary times. Milton Friedman, the most prominent of the monetarists, pointed out that the inflation-unemployment trade-off, or the Phillips curve, was not stable, but shifted up along the inflation dimension as people adjusted their inflation expectations. Friedman believed that people had adaptive expectations and would adjust their inflation expectations rather slowly. In the early 80s, a new group of economists stressed that not only did inflation expectations adjust rather quickly, but also that people used all their knowledge of the economy and the monetary policy when forming expectations. They believed that people have rational expectations. They thought that the economy works the way people expect, and that people form expectations using all available information without making systematic mistakes. If people have rational expectations, monetary policy is neutral also in the short run. The quantitative theory of inflation states that a higher rate of growth of the money supply leads to faster inflation. At the heart of this theory is the equation of exchange that states that income at current prices is equal to the money supply times the velocity of money. The velocity of money is the number of times that each dollar note must change hands over the year so that all transactions are paid for. The quantity theory of inflation makes the assumption that the velocity of money does not change through time and that the economy is always at potential output, so that changes in the money supply, M, translate into changes in the level of prices, P. In other words, inflation. The demand-pull inflation theory is a more sophisticated version of the quantity theory of inflation. In this theory, it is recognized that higher money supply lowers interest rates and stimulates investment and consumption, raising total spending. If total spending increases faster than total output, however, the result is a continual increase in the price level, in other words, inflation, Many economists believe that the increasing inflation of the 1960s and 1970s was an example of demand-pull inflation. Inflation could also arise from increases in the cost of production. This is what economists call cost-push inflation. For example, a sudden increase in the cost of imported materials like petroleum or copper would force firms to raise their prices and could trigger a wage or price spiral where workers demand higher wages to protect their purchasing power, and firms agree to the wage increases just to increase prices even further. This is the end of Part 1, the roles and kinds of money and macroeconomic activity. In the next video, we'll cover commercial banks and other financial intermediaries.